Everybody knows the name Beastie Boys. Everybody knows their songs. Everybody knows that the Beastie Boys fought for your right to party. Without the Beastie Boys, you would not be partying tonight. No siree. But what most people don't know, what only the true fans know, is that the Beastie Boys started as a hardcore band, a punk band playing instruments, not rapping over turntable scratches. Hey ladies, my name is Dan Frampton, and today we're gonna go through the Beastie Boys hardcore catalog. Was it really that good? Should they have changed paths? Is hip hop really the right way that they should have gone? All that and more in today's video. Now, admittedly, it's not the deepest rabbit hole. We're not gonna need to get our spelunking gear on. We're not gonna need any like pickaxes or flashlights or anything like that. There really only was one record that was them as a hardcore band. And guess what? Ad Rock wasn't a founding member. To be clear, they put out two hardcore records, but only one of them was them as a hardcore band. By the time they put out their second hardcore record, they were already pop superstars. So for this rabbit hole, all we're gonna need to do is strap on some Doc Martens, maybe some like workman's jeans or whatever, and then go on down to New York City for the record Pollywog Stew. Now this record features the founding members. We got John Barry on the guitar, Kate Salinger on the drums, which are not really names that you associate with the Beastie Boys, but these two people are official Beastie Boys. And then we get MCA, God rest his soul, and also Mike D playing some vocals. That's right, he played those vocals. This little hardcore EP would be written and recorded in 1982 and then re-released in 1989. And then re-released as some old bullshit in like 1994. But this record wastes no time getting fast, getting ignorant, getting all up in your face with this amazing theme song, such a great opener, and it's called Beastie Boys. It's basically them just like spelling Beastie Boys really fast and then saying Beastie Boys really fast and then just playing music really, really fast. So now you know who they are, you know what they are, and what they sound like. What more do you need? Well, there's a full record here. And as we move on to the next track, Transit Cop, we're realizing we're dealing with a ripper of a band. And not only a ripper of a band, but a band so early on in the hardcore movement. This is like early goings. And the Beastie Boys were there right in the thick of it. And really, they have a distinct sound. They got these raspy, snotty-ass vocals that sound just like Beastie Boy vocals. This whole aesthetic, this whole attitude is nailed in like a minute and a half. So by the time we get to the next song, Jimmy, we're like, okay, let's go. But this is when the band throws us a little bit of a curveball when they slow it down for this kind of noisy instrumental number on the track, Jimmy. But then they move right into the loud fastness when they go into Holy Snappers. Just so much energy, so simple. They're accomplishing so much with so little. It's very impressive. Then we move on to Riot Fight, where we get some blast beats. What's this? Beastie Boys playing blast beats? Kinda cool, kinda loving it. It's a 31 second song that just goes Mach 5. There's no adherence to any sort of pop structure. There's no like verse, chorus, anything going on here, and I love every bit of it. It's so noisy, it's so aggressive. We move on to the track Ode To, and that's just like a hard as fuck song. And right after that hard as fuck song, we get a little country number known as Michelle's Farm. They're just hitting us with this little parody country jam before it just blasts off into outer space and blasts rocket fuel all over our naked bodies. Just ugly as hell. And then we close off the record with what would become Beastie Boys' main hardcore song, and that is a song called A Grade on Mojo. And there is a little bit of a backstory here on this song, A Grade on Mojo. Apparently they got kicked out of a little bit of a venue back in the day, and then they came back dressed all in black for an egg raid. They had a bunch of eggs and they were ready to do some splattering. So after they did the egg raid on Mojo, they thought, this is gonna be a great song. And in fact, it was a great song. So after listening to this record, it's clear to me that they're not just a good punk band, they're one of the greats and could have been considered one of the greats had they just moved in this direction. But that's not the direction they went in. Everybody knows that. They fought for the right to party all the way to Brooklyn or whatever. And I think one of the main reasons it gets overlooked as one of the great punk records is because they really did go on to become pop sensations. And people that are pop sensations can't really be glorified by the punk scene, because that kind of goes against the whole ethos or whatever, which I think is total crap. The Beastie Boys were one of the acts that got me into music in general. So when I got into punk and learned that they were a punk band, everything just clicked for me. That it all just came from the same places of creativity, you know? This is the back of the record over here, where we get a picture of the original founding members over here. But then we move into the 90s, and in the 90s, the Beastie Boys become the Beastie Boys. We already got Ill Communication. We already got License to Ill. These guys have track after track, and they are household names by this point. So they get together to come up with ideas for their next record. So while jamming and while coming up with different kind of sample ideas, they end up accidentally writing a whole bunch of new hardcore songs. So now we're in the year 1995. The world knows the Beastie Boys. They're like infamous in places, notorious in other places. They're the Beastie Boys, and they have enough material to put out an entire hardcore record. And that's what they do on Alio e Olio over here. The people have got to know. And right off the bat, you can tell that this aesthetic is absolutely masterfully executed. Look at this guy. You get the guy with his head in the vice grip. He's turning it himself. He's drawn so very, very poorly. All of, like, the band name is very, very poorly written across the top. It's all just like so clunky and shitty and just like totally a hardcore record. It's got to have something on the front, right? Well, we don't really care about the art. It's about the music on this thing. So here's this piece of artwork that's going to be the front cover of our record in 1995, when we're known as millionaire pop stars. I love this move. I absolutely love this move. I love how they took their fame, they took their notoriety, and they were like, hey, there's this whole other thing that goes on just beneath the surface of this glitzy, glam, MTV type stuff, okay? There's punk, there's hardcore, and it is kind of the lifeblood of the actual music scene. That's what breeds the people and gives them the right to do it independently, DIY, from town to town to venue to venue. Okay, so without that, there is no Beastie Boys, there is no Green Day, there is no Offspring, yada, yada, yada. And the Beastie Boys were the group to kind of highlight that. And the first song is called Brand New, and it's just right off the bat, it's still snotty, it's still brash, it's still fast and ignorant. You gotta love it. This is hardcore music. And right away I'm hearing, oh my God, there's like little improvements on the recording quality here. This is actually one of the best punk songs I've ever heard. And little did I know, it was just gonna get better and better as this thing played through. And then we get the next song, Deal With It, and their voices just rule. Their voices were built for this genre of music. And yes, their voices are very famous for that other genre of music that they do. They do it very well, don't get me wrong. And that same sort of attitude that we get on their rap pop songs is just intensified here. They're just off the rails, totally unhinged, and I love it. They're just allowing any creative idea to come in and be outputted, you know? And on the next song, believe me, there is no signs of slowing down. They're ripping and roaring right through this thing. And like a freight train, we get Nervous Assistant next, and by the time you get to track 6, you catch a bad one, you're gonna be absolutely hooked to this. The vocals and backing vocals are amazing, and they're not just doing what they do in the rap stuff, they're doing hardcore punk. It doesn't sound just like the Beastie Boys rapping over hardcore music, which is what you would think it would sound like, but that's not it at all. If it was that, that would be the corniest shit in the world. But you know what's not corny? The next song, I Can't Think Straight. This is probably my favorite song out of the whole batch of Beastie Boys hardcore songs. And then we get to the 8th song, which is actually the last song on the original pressing of this record. It's called I Want Some, and what a blood pumping closer this thing is. They're just screaming and yelling their asses off. And there's also these kind of like alternative rock backing vocals. I don't know how to like describe it any better than that. It's just high energy and highly addictive, and it makes you wish that the Beastie Boys would just shut up and be a punk band already. But the record store release has some pretty good songs on it too, like Soba Violence, Nothing to Say, and it has this cover of Light My Fire, which is very tender and very sensual at the very end of this thing. And I think it's a very interesting way to end this hardcore record. Come on, baby, light my fire. And the chaotic synth leads and soba violence are like so abrasive that I want to like push them away, but they're so cool sounding that I'm just like, come in, stab me in my ears, synth leads. So abrasive, so in your face, it doesn't give a fuck. The Beastie Boys should be credited with pushing the genre forward. They should be credited as one of the best punk rock hardcore bands to have ever done it. They should also be celebrated for using their limelight to shine the spotlight on the hardcore scene. That's very chill of them. They didn't need to do that. And they weren't cashing in on some hardcore punk thing, and because like punk was really big at the time, they could have just put out like a pop punk record and it would have like topped the charts. But that's not what they did. They put out a fucking hardcore punk record, as hardcore punk as you could. And that's at the peak of their popularity. You gotta respect it. I love their unique take on bridges and breakdowns with no commitment to any sort of set structure or whatever. It's blistering and invigorating music. I don't know how something so angry can be so charming. But again, that's what I say to myself every time I look in the mirror. And if you like this video, please like, comment, and subscribe. Ring the bell if you're cool as hell, and until my next upload, watch another upload.